Welcome everyone. We are continuing our series of CAD paper discussions, and today we are going to look at CAD 2005 verbal section. So before we get into that, a quick introduction. Hi, I'm Munira Lokhandwala and I'm Calcutta alumna, a serial 100 percentiler in the CAD and a 99 percentiler in GMAT. I also have a CAD verbal book published by Wiley and available on Amazon. Besides this YouTube CAD Unacademy channel, you can also find me on the Unacademy app. So guys, please download the app, install it, and within that, you have to enroll for the Plus CAD program, right? Besides the Plus CAD program, if you go for the CAD subscription, you also get special classes, you get a lot of free courses. So there is enough content for you to swim in for months and months, right? Which is what you need right now for your preparation. So which subscription exactly to go for? We can talk towards the end of the session. You can use my code Munira10 to get 10% discount, right? Great. So before we begin, here is the puzzle that I gave you the last time, yesterday evening, right? You have two wooden cubes which have digit painters on each face in such a way that it's possible to display any date of the month. Okay. So you should be able to display dates like 15, like 7, right? So what are the dates that you want to display, guys? Starting from 01. I want to display all dates till 31, right? Okay, which means that first of all, 1 should be on both the cubes, right? Both the cubes should have 1 each. Otherwise, how will I get the number 11? Similarly, both the cubes should have the number 2 each. Otherwise, how will I get the number 22, right? Now, what about 0? We don't need a 00. But we need to get all possibilities starting from 01 till 09. So 0 should be matched with each of the other numbers. And that's why, guys, even 0 you will need on both the cubes. Right? Because 0 has to be matched with all the numbers. If I just keep 0 on one cube, I can max match 0 with 6 other numbers, not all the numbers. So 0 has to be on both the cubes. So I have used up 3 places in each of the cubes, and now I have 6 places left, right? 3 in this cube and 3 in this cube. So great, let's fill it up. We can fill it up with 3, 4, 5, right? 6, 7, and 8. But this is not enough, yeah? Where should I put the 9? We should have a 9 somewhere. I need to write 09 and 19 and 29. So the trick here is that the normal way in which we write 6, right, can be flipped to make a 9. So this is what will go on your cubes. And whenever you need a 9, you'll just flip this 6. And that's how your dates like 09, 19, and 29 will work out, right? So this is the way to label the cubes. Great. Now let's look at the verbal section. So 2005 verbal section had 30 questions, and there were 2 years in the CAD, 2004 and 2005, when there was differential marking. Okay, so some questions had 1 mark, some questions had 2 marks, right? So 2005 also, you had 10 questions of 1 mark and 20 questions of 2 marks, evaluating to 30 questions, total 50 marks. So out of those 30 questions, guys, I'm not using questions that involve grammar and questions that are, you know, involving which word to put in, because they are not relevant for us. So out of the 30 questions, I have used the 19 questions, out of which 12 are RC. RC, the personal favorite of all CAT test takers, right? 3 of them are para jumbles, and you have 4 of them, which is para completions. Para completions, I've always told you, is so close to para jumbles also and para summaries. So we should be good at para completions as well, right? And great, so these 19 questions is what we are going to discuss right now. Some of these passages are heavy. So I would recommend that first of all, please, please, please go to the description box, download the PDF, solve it by yourself, and then look at the video solution, okay? And if, you know, it gets a little heavy, then just pause it and continue it, but don't miss out on this, because even the current CAD passages, some of the passages in 18 and 19 and even 17, right, have these sort of heavy passages. So doing heavy passages, I know, can lead to sleepless nights, but we have to do them. Okay. So great. Let's read the first passage. A game of strategy as currently conceived in game theory is a situation in which two or more players make choices among available alternatives. The totality of choices determines the outcome of the game, and it is assumed that the rank order of preferences for the outcomes is different for different players. That is an assumption, right? Thus, the interests of the players are generally in conflict. Interest is conflict is one of the outcomes. It's a conclusion, right? Why? Because there are different preferences for outcomes. Whether these interests are diametrically opposite or only partially opposed depends on the type of game. Psychologically, most interesting situations arise when the interests of the player are partly coincident and partly opposed. Because then one can postulate not only a conflict between the players because of the opposition, right, but also inner conflicts within the players. Each is torn between a tendency to cooperate so as to promote the common interest and a tendency to compete so as to enhance his own individual interest. Internal conflicts are always psychologically interesting. What we vaguely call interesting psychology is in very great measure the psychology of inner conflict. So what is interesting, guys, is inner conflict, not outer conflict. Inner conflict is also held to be an important component of serious literature as distinguished from less serious genres. The classical tragedy as well as the serious novel reveals the inner conflict of central figures. The superficial adventure story, on the other hand, depicts only external conflict, that is, the threats to the person with whom the reader or viewer identifies. In these stories, exclusively from external obstacles and from the adversaries who create them. On the most primitive level, this sort of external conflict is psychologically empty. In the fisticuffs between the protagonist of good and evil, no psychological problems are involved, or at any rate, none are depicted in juvenile representations of conflict. Okay, so what they're saying is that in, what is interesting is internal conflict, and even good literature, heavy, serious literature, right, looks at internal, inner conflict and not this external conflict that is basically psychologically empty. Okay, so inner conflict lends heaviness to things. The detective story, the adult analog of a juvenile adventure tale, has at times been described as a glorification of intellectualized conflict. However, a great deal of the interest in the plot of these stories is sustained by withholding the unraveling of a solution to a problem. The effort of solving the problem is in itself not a conflict if the adversary, the unknown criminal, remains passive. So they're saying that the detective novel is supposed to have some conflict, right, intellectualized conflict, but a lot of interest is maintained by not giving us who the killer is. The effort of solving the problem, right, if the adversary remains passive, like nature, is not much. Like, whose secrets the scientist supposedly unravels by deduction. If the adversary actively puts obstacles in the detective's path towards the solution, there is genuine conflict. But the conflict is psychologically interesting only to the extent that it contains irrational components, such as a tactical error on the criminal's part or the detective's insight into some psychological quirk of the criminal or something of this sort. Conflict conducted in a purely rational manner is psychologically no more interesting than a standard Western. Western is a type of an American movie with cowboys and all. For example, tic-tac-toe played perfectly by both players is completely devoid of psychological interest. Chess may be psychologically interesting, but only to the extent that it is played not quite rationally. Played completely rationally, anything will not be interesting, whether it's chess, whether it's tic-tac-toe, right? So what can make things interesting are some, tactical error or something which is different from a rational way of playing. In short, a pure conflict of interest, although it offers a wealth of interesting conceptual problems, is not interesting psychologically. For psychological interest, you need to have partly incidental, partly different conflict of interest, right? Whereas in a pure conflict of interest, that's not possible. Except to the extent that it conducts, departs from rational norms. Right. So now let's look at questions. This is mostly about inner conflict and external conflict. internal conflicts are psychologically more interesting than external conflicts because internal conflicts form an important component of serious literature. So this is an effect. Because internal conflicts are psychologically interesting, this becomes serious literature. This is not the cause. See, I want internal conflicts are more interesting because I want a cause to this. Whereas one is an effect to what is given. So one is wrong. Only juveniles or very few adults actually experience. Who is experiencing? There's nothing spoken about what is experience. It's mostly about games and literature. In situations of internal conflict, individuals experience a dilemma in resolving their own preferences for different outcomes. This is looking good. This is the reason why they are more interesting, because there is a dilemma. Should I cooperate or should I not cooperate? So 3 is looking good. There are no threats to the reader or viewer in case. Again, the reader is never going to face threat, whether it's internal conflict or external conflict. Everything is in the book, right? So this is completely bakwas. Option. So answer is option 3. Which, according to the author, would qualify as interesting psychology. Interesting psychology means you have a dilemma. Okay. अभी डायलमा यूज करने से डायलमा नहीं होता है. स्टैटिस्टिशियंस डायलमा और चूजिंग द बेस्ट मेथड. सो दैट इज अ वेरी क्लियर कट मैथमेटिकल अप्रोच टू डू दिस. देयर इज नो डायलमा हियर. सो वन इज आउट. अ चेस प्लेयर प्रेडिकमेंट और अडॉप्टिंग अ डिफेंसिव स्ट्रेटजी अगेंस्ट एन अग्रेसिव अपोनेंट. सो या अ चेस प्लेयर माइट वॉन्ट टू गो फॉर एन ऑफेंसिव स्ट्रेटजी और अ डिफेंसिव स्ट्रेटजी एंड देयर इज अ डायलमा हियर ऑन विच स्ट्रेटजी टू गो फॉर, राइट? So there is some conflict within the chess player. So this may survive. This may work. A mountaineer's choice of the best path. Again, this is a mathematically, you know, you can find out rationally which is the best path. So 3 is also out, right? A finance manager's quandary over the best way of raising money from the market. Again, there is a very clear best way. There is no conflict here. I need to think of 2 possibilities to something. And there is, you know, potential of losing one, gaining another, etc., which is not happening in any of the options except the second option. So your answer here is option 2. Right? Great. Let's look at the next 2 questions. According to the passage, which are the following options about the application of game theory to a conflict of interest situation is true? Okay. So you want to say ki if I have game theory application, outcome, not an assumption. The first is an assumption that you have to assume this, then only you get a conflict of interest. It is not an application of the conflict of interest. The application is that you have to accept that interests of different players are often in conflict. So 2 is looking good. Right? 1 is not looking good. Not assuming that the interests are in complete. Again, this is an assumption. So answer here is option 2. The problem solving process of a scientist is different from that of a detective because. So scientists study inanimate objects. Wo to bataya gaya hai, right? Passive study hota hai. Yahan pe. Like nature, whose interest secrets the scientist unravels. Because nature is passive, but the detective may actually face some sort of active obstacles by criminals, right? So one doesn't work. Scientists study known objects. No, they may study unknown objects also, right? But those objects are passive. So 2 is wrong. Scientists study phenomena that are not actively altered, that have been deliberately influenced to mislead. So 3 is looking good. Scientists study psychologically interesting phenomena, while detectives study, no, this is not true. And there's no psychologically interesting with scientists, right? So the only answer here is option 3, right? Great. Now let's look at the jumble paragraphs. Very interesting. Five sentences, you have to arrange them in the right order so that it makes a coherent paragraph, right? So see, straight away you have similarly turning to caste. So you know that there's a link somewhere, right? Even though being lower caste is undoubtedly a separate cause of disparity, its impact is all the greater when the lower caste families also happen to be poor. Belonging to a privileged class can help a woman to overcome many barriers that obstruct women from less thriving classes. It is the interactive presence. So see, this talks about class, this talks about caste. Of these two kinds of deprivation, which two kinds? These two kinds. So this is also as a link here also. Being low class and being female, that massively impoverishes women from the less privileged classes. So ek to these ka link dhoondna hai, there's a class here. A congruence of class deprivation and gender discrimination can blight the lives of poorer women very severely. So yahan pe dekho, two deprivations likha hai. So DC is a clear link. Right? A congruence of class deprivation, presence of these two kinds of deprivation, right? So DC is a link, which means I can at least eliminate third option and even the fourth option, right? Gender is certainly a contributor to societal inequality, but it does not act independently of class. So first of all, is clearly a good beginner, right? It introduces the whole gender thing, that is one. Right, and it does not act independently of class. Ke baad B explains E, so there is an EB link, right? And finally, class ke baare mein baat. This is class, class, and at the end you will say similarly turning to caste. So A has to end. So it's answer 2. E has to begin. B explains E, then B, then C, and then A. That's your right answer, right? So it's a little tricky, but they are very, very clear hints. Correct? That caste only comes at one place and you have two kind of deprivation, and then you also have, you know, an explanation of E. So this is not a very difficult one to solve. Okay, next question. What identities thus defined by contrast, divergence with the West becomes central? Indian religious literature such as the Bhagavad Gita or the Tantric texts, which are identified as differing from secular writings, elicits much greater interest in the West than to other writings, including India's long history of heterodoxy. There is a similar neglect of Indian writing on non-religious subjects. So BC ka link hai, Indian religious right elicits much greater interest than to other Indian writings, and there's a similar neglect of Indian writing on non-religious subjects. So religious, non-religious. BC ka link is clearly there. Now, first option can be eliminated, third option can be eliminated. We are looking at 2 or 4. Now, if you see, there is a similar neglect. The exception is the Kama Sutra. So E has to follow BC, right? Let's read the whole thing. Through selective emphasis, that point of differences with the West, other civilizations can in this way be redefined in alien terms, which can be exotic and charming, or else bizarre and terrifying, or simply strange and engaging. The exception is the Kama Sutra can only follow C. There's a neglect, but there is an interest here. So BCE link, guys, we are looking at the fourth option. Okay, BCE. And then, you know, you speak about this collective emphasis because, you know, for some it works, for some it doesn't work. And then what identities thus defined by contrast gives a nice conclusion, right? So answer is option 4. Great. Seventh question. This is now orthodoxy to which I subscribe up to a point. It emerged from the mathematics of chance and statistics. What is it? What is this? Therefore, the risk is measurable and manageable. The fundamental concept, prices are not predictable, but the mathematical laws of chance can describe the fluctuations. There is a DC link, right? Which means all options have the DC link. But take care, we know that we are right. The DC link is definitely there. This is how what these business schools now call modern finance was born. This is the it. So there is an EB link also. Now if you look at the EB link, guys, only second option works. So you start with E, and you know, modern finance was born. It emerged from the mathematics of chance and statistics. The fundamental concept behind is this, right? So B follows and then C, and then finally you have A. EBDCA. Right? Second option. Great. Let's look at the next reading comprehension. Guys, please, I know I'm taking up a part of the screen, but you have the PDF right there in the description box. Download it and keep it beside you. Read from the PDF, right? Crinoline and Crockett are out. As yet, no political activists have thrown themselves in front of the Royal Horse on Derby Day. Even so, some historians can spot the parallels. It's a time of rapid technological change. It is a period when the dominance of the world superpower is coming under threat. It is an epoch when prosperity masks underlying economic strain. And crucially, it is a time when policymakers are confident that all is for the best in the best of all possible worlds. Welcome to the Edwardian summer of the second age of globalization. So this is what it is, right? When people are confident that it's the best of all possible worlds, that's the Edwardian summer. Spare a moment to take stock of what's been happening in the past few months. Let's start with the oil price, which has rocketed to more than $65 a barrel, more than double its level 18 months ago. The accepted wisdom is that we shouldn't worry our little heads about that, because the incentives are there for business to build new production and refining capacity, which will effortlessly bring demand and supply back into balance and bring crude prices back to $25 a barrel, as Tommy Copper used to say, just like that. So the just like that here is sarcastic, because it's not easy to build production and refining capacity, right? And effortlessly demand, you know, this whole starting from your little heads and everything, right? This whole sentence, in two sentences, whatever, it's completely sarcastic. Just like that, things are not going to go back to normal. Then there's the result of the French referendum on the European Constitution, seen as thick-headed Luddites railing vainly against the modern world. What the French need to realize, the argument went, was that there was no alternative to the reforms that would make the country more flexible, more competitive, more dynamic. Just the sort of reforms that allowed Gate Gourmet to sack hundreds of its staff at Heathrow after the sort of ultimatum that used to be handed out by Victorian mill owners. An alternative way of looking at the French now is that our neighbors translate flexibility as your fire. Okay, so the result of the French referendum is that using flexibility, they are saying that the reforms are making France more dynamic, etc., right? And using flexibility, they're trying to sack people. Finally, take a squint at the US. Just like Britain a century ago, a period of unquestioned superiority is drawing to a close. China is still a long way from matching America's wealth, but it is growing at a stupendous rate, and economic strength brings geopolitical clout. Already there is evidence of a new scramble for Africa as Washington and Beijing compete for oil stocks. Moreover, beneath the surface of the US economy, all is not well. Growth looks healthy enough, but the competition from China and elsewhere has meant the world's biggest economy now imports far more than it exports. The US is living beyond its means, but in this time of studied complacency, a current account deficit worth 6% of GDP is seen as a sign of strength, not weakness. So there's problem with France, there's problem with the oil prices, and then there's a problem with the US because China is now coming up. Both Washington and Beijing are competing for the same oil stocks, right? And now US is living beyond its means. Okay, so this is just listing all the kind of problems that are currently taking place in the world. In this new Edwardian summer, comfort is taken from the fact that dearer oil has not had the savage inflationary consequences of 1973-74. When a fourfold increase in the cost of crude brought an abrupt end to a post-war boom. That had gone on uninterrupted for a quarter of a century. True, the cost of living has been affected by higher transport costs, but we are talking of inflation at 2.3% and not 27%. Okay, so earlier when oil became very pricey, there was the savage, there were a lot of consequences, right? And that cost of crude going up actually brought to an end the post-war boom. But now the inflation is less, yet the idea that higher oil prices are of little consequence is fanciful. Higher oil price, the author is saying, will make a difference. If people are paying more to fill up their cars, it leaves them with less to spend on everything else. And there's a reluctance to consume less. In the 1970s, unions were strong and able to negotiate large compensatory pay deals that served to intensify inflationary pressure. So it's explaining why there was more inflation yesterday. Earlier. In 2005, that avenue was pretty much closed off, but the abolition of all the controls on credit that existed in the 1970s means that households are invited to borrow more rather than consume less. So instead of people being made to consume less, they're actually made to borrow and consume more. Because there are no controls on how much credit can be given. The knock-on effects of higher oil prices are thus felt in different ways through higher level of indebtedness, in inflated asset prices, and in balance of payment deficits. So these are the ways in which higher oil prices can be, the effect of that can be seen. There are those who point out rightly that modern industrial capitalism has proved mightily resilient these past 250 years, and that a sign of the enduring strength of the system has been the way it apparently shrugged off everything, a stock market crash, 9/11, rising oil prices that have been thrown at it in the half decade since the millennium. Even so, there are at least three reasons for concern. First, we have been here before. In terms of the fact that modern industrial capitalism has been resilient, there are still three reasons for us to have concern. First, we have been here before. In terms of political economy, the first era of globalization mirrored our own. There was a belief in unfettered capital flows, in free migration. Eventually, though, there was a backlash manifested in a struggle between free traders and protectionists and in rising labor militancy. Okay, so all these things have happened in the past. Second, the world is traditionally at its most fragile when the global balance of power is in flux, as it is right now. By the end of the 19th century, Britain's role as the hegemonic power was being challenged by the US, Germany, and Japan. And we know what happened, right? Beginning of 20th century, we had two wars. While the Ottoman and Habsburg Empire were clearly in rapid decline. Looking ahead from 2005, it's clear that over the next two or three decades, both China and India, which together account for half the world's population, will flex their muscles. Finally, there's a question of what rising oil prices tell us. The emergence of China and India means global demand for crude is likely to remain high at a time when experts say production is about to top out. If supply constraints start to bite, any decline in the prices are likely to be short-term cyclical affairs, punctuating a long upward trend. So as long as oil prices are rising and there are supply constraints, you will not have any decrease in prices. You will still have an upward trend, okay, for the oil price. Great. A pretty depressing essay to be read during the corona times, right? But great, let's look at questions. By the expression Edwardian summer, the author refers to a period in which there is no luxury, right? If you just go back and see what is the line just before Edwardian summer, it says policymakers are confident that all is best in all the possible worlds. There is nothing spoken about, and there's comfort, right? That's what the Edwardian year means. So in parallel, luxury ka to there is nothing spoken about, but there is a sense of complacency among people. People are relaxed. A culmination of all round, no, it's not saying that this prosperity is going to end. And there is no there may be imminent danger, but again, it's not about prosperity. It's about people feeling everything is all right. It is a sense. It's not that there is actually any need for it, but there's a sense of complacency. In that sense, two is better than four. First of all, the danger may not imminent means it's just right there. So you don't know whether how close the danger is, first of all. right? And there is no prosperity. It's just that people are complacent because of prosperity, right? That's what it's about. So it's the second option. What, according to the author, has resulted in a widespread belief in the resilience of modern capitalism? Why is there a belief, right? Because the modern capitalism has withstood a lot of things, right? A stock market crash, 9/11, rising oil prices, it has withstood all this. So that's why there is belief in the resilience of modern capitalism. Despite shocks, no, inflated asset prices, that's not what was mentioned, right? Increase in the prosperity of Western countries and China, despite not China. China is not involved. China is just rising. Continued growth of Western economies despite a rise. This is good, right? Terrorism, oil prices, everything. Let's keep this. The success of continued reforms aimed at making Western economies more dynamic. No, and no reforms. Reforms was a little bit with France, not overall for capitalism, right? So here, your answer is option 2 for question 1, and here the option is, right answer is option 3, right? Great. Next one. Which of the following best represents the key argument made by the authors? The author is saying, jao, there are problems. That's what the author is saying. And he gives reasons for the problems, right? And the rise in oil prices is one of the most predominant reasons. Right, the belief and capable will be belied soon, that we don't know, because in fact he says that people who believe, rightly so, has proved mightily resilient. So he's not saying that capitalism is going to get belied. Belied means that people will stop believing in it, right? So 2 is not possible. Widespread prosperity leads to neglect of early signs of underlying economic weakness. No, underlying economic weakness is not there, guys. Right? So that's where the problem is with option 3. A crisis is imminent in the West given the growth and the increase. Partly true. Right? But this is the overall, this is neatly given in the last conclusion. Right? That first is this, second is this, third is this. So that's what the answer is, option 1. What can be inferred about the author's view when he states, used to say, I told you it's just sarcastic. It is not going to work out, is what he feels. So has incentives to build and therefore, no, it's sarcasm. One is definitely wrong. There would be a correction in the price levels of oil once new production capacity is added. No, sarcasm, right? The decline in oil prices is likely to be short-term in nature, perhaps. It is not necessary that oil prices would go down to earlier levels, right? So first of all, decline hoga ke nahi also, we don't know. So between 3 and 4, 4 is better, where the person is saying that oil prices will not go down to earlier levels. Short term, long term, not mentioned, right? So answer here is option 4. Earlier question answer was option 1, right? Great. Next set. Oh, Derrida. This was some amazing passage here. So yes, this cat I had got 100 percentile overall, and I remember reading this passage and wondering, oh my god, how are other people taking this, right? Because it's very, very difficult to read. But earlier one also was not easy, but at least there was some sort of reality, right? Whereas here it's all very, very, very abstract. So let's read it. While complex in the extreme, Derrida's work has proven to be a particularly influential approach to the analysis of the ways in which language structures our understanding of ourselves and the world we inhabit, an approach he termed deconstruction. So Derrida says that language is very important to understand ourselves, and the way he has analyzed language, that approach is deconstruction. So I'm just helping y'all, right, and us, all of us, to understand what is given in this. And how do we understand it, right? See, while complex, complex we can already make out. What is important is Derrida's work is influential, helps us understand how language helps us understand ourselves. And his work is termed as deconstruction. That's all you need to understand. If you can pick up, what is the subject? What is the object, right? So influential approach. And these are the other important phrases attached to it. That's all. In its simplest, so this is also bakwas, simplest formulation. Deconstruction can be taken to refer to a strategy which seeks to uncover layers of hidden meaning in a text. Okay, na? This is fine. So don't go too deeply methodological strategy, right? Yeah, it's a strategy that helps to uncover hidden meaning. The term text in this respect does not refer simply to a written communication. It can be something that we reproduce constantly in everyday spoken, written, blah, blah. So text is not just written. Text is something that can be speech also. At the heart of Derrida's deconstructive approach is his critique, right? So he criticizes the totalitarian impulse of the Enlightenment pursuit to bring all that exists under one language. This behavior he calls as logocentrism. So what is the main thing? He says that, you know, Enlightenment ke naam pe, they're getting everything in one language, and that is wrong, and that method of getting everything in one language is logocentrism. So Derrida is against logocentrism. Logocentrism is the search for a rational language that is able to know and represent the world and all its aspects perfectly and accurately. So logocentrism is a very rational way for language. Okay? The way we normally think, everything should be able to be expressed, right? Its totalitarian dimension for Derrida at least lies primarily in its tendency to marginalize or dismiss. So it is totalitarian, means, you know, it's an absolute dictatorial thing. It has to be applied on everything, which may not happen, right? You will marginalize things that will not comply with this rational language, right? That's what is the next sentence. It's totalitarian dimension. It has a tendency, logocentrism has a tendency to marginalize, means ignore, that does not neatly comply with its linguistic representations. A tendency that throughout history has all too frequently been manifested in the form of authoritarian institutions. So, he's comparing logocentrism to things like dictatorship also. Thus, logocentrism has, in its search for the truth of absolute representation, subsumed difference and oppressed that which it designates as its alien other. Okay, so it has suppressed any differences, and it has removed anything that doesn't match. For Derrida, Western civilization has been built upon such a systematic assault on alien cultures, typically in the name of reason and progress. So you just start with what is, you know, Derrida's work called. It is called deconstruction. Okay. And what is deconstruction? It's trying to find hidden meanings. And he is against logocentrism. What is logocentrism? It is a rational language which tries to get everything together. That's not possible. That's more or less your first paragraph. Now you get into what deconstruction is. In response to logocentrism, deconstruction posits the idea that the mechanism by which this process of marginalization and the ordering of truth occurs is through establishing systems of binary opposition. Okay, so he's saying that in, you know, this the way marginalization occurs, the way logocentrism works, is they establish systems of binary opposition. Oppositional linguistic dualism, such as rational, irrational, culture, nature, good, bad, are not, however, construed as equal partners. So now Derrida says they are not binary opposites, they are not equal partners. As this you can completely forget. Who cares? Rather, they exist in a series of hierarchical relationships, with the first term normally occupying a superior position. So obviously, rational occupies a superior position compared to irrational. They are not equal, right? Derrida defines a relationship between such oppositional terms using the neologism difference, not different, but difference, because one is higher than the other. This refers to the realization that in any statement, oppositional terms differ from each other, right? And at the same time, there is a hierarchical relationship. It is this latter point which is perhaps the key to understanding Derrida's approach to deconstruction. Okay, great. If we understand that there are in opposition, there is a hierarchy, that's the main point. Okay, let's look at what comes next. For the fact at any given time, one term must differ to its oppositional other means that the two terms are constantly in a state of interdependence. They can't be independent of each other. The presence of one is dependent upon the absence or absent presence of the other. Absent presence, bakwas. Absence of the other. Such as in the case of good and evil. Whereby to understand the nature of one, you must constantly relate it to the absent term in order to grasp its meaning. That is, to do good, we must understand that our act is not evil. For without that comparison, the term becomes meaningless. Put simply, deconstruction represents an attempt to demonstrate the absent presence of this oppositional other to show that what we say or write is in not itself expressive simply. So this is again just repeating of what is present but also of what is absent. Thus, deconstruction seeks to reveal the interdependence of apparently dichotomous terms. They may seem opposites but they are interdependent and their meanings relative to their textual context. That is, within the linguistic power relations which structure dichotomous terms hierarchically. In Derrida's own words, a deconstructive reading must always aim at a certain relationship, unperceived by the writer, between what he commands and what he does not command. It attempts to make the not seen visible, accessible to sight means visible. Okay. So, yeah. A deconstructive must find, you know, relationship which even the writer didn't know between what is present and what is absent. So even what is not seen can be made visible. Meaning then is never fixed or stable, whatever the intention of the author of a text. So meaning can, based on interpretation, right, the meaning can change. Because language is dynamic and we have to not just believe what is present but also what is absent. Thus any act of interpretation must refer not only to what the author of a text intends, but also to what is absent from his or her intention. Again, it's present, absent, present, absent. This insight leads once again to Derrida's further rejection of the idea of the definitive authority of the intentional agent or subject. There is no single authority, that's what he says. The subject is decentered. It is conceived as the outcome of relations of difference. As author of its own biography, the subject thus becomes the ideological fiction of modernity, and it is logocentric philosophy, one that depends upon the formation of hierarchical dualisms. Present, absent, right? That's all this is about. That's it. There's a lot of repetition within it. Of course, the sentences are long, but if you just grasp this, it's more than enough. You can start looking at questions. According to the passage, Derrida believes that reality can be construed only through the use of rational. No, he does not believe that. He does not believe in rational analysis. That is what logocentrism talks about. So one is out. Language limits our construction of reality. No, it's not about. In fact, language is not supposed to limit, is what he says, right? A universal language. He is against a universal language. He's against logocentrism. So best is option 4. We need to uncover the hidden meaning in a system of relations, right? So he says there's hidden meaning within the text, clearly given in the beginning. To Derrida, logocentrism does not imply a totalitarian impulse. It does imply, so this is gone, a domain of representative language. It does imply this. Interdependence, no, this is what Derrida himself feels. This is deconstruction. So 3 is looking good. A strategy that seeks to suppress hidden meanings in a text, that is not, there's no active suppression here by logocentrism, right? So 4 is also wrong. Best is option 3. Great, let's look at the next one. According to the passage, Derrida believes that the system of binary opposition, right? Yeah, so there is a prioritization here, there is a hierarchy. There is no single equal partners nahi hai, right? This is clearly given, guys. Here. In response, that is through claims, rather they exist in a series of hierarchical relationships. Clearly given, right? So here, one is looking very, very good. Reconciles contradictions and dualities. No, see, who is going for binary opposition? It's logocentrism. So they don't do any reconciliation. Weakens the process of marginalization. No, it strengthens because it goes with logocentrism. It deconstructs reality. No, Derrida reconstructs reality, right? So best is option 1. Derrida rejects the idea of definitive authority of the subject because interpretation of the text may not make the unseen visible. Yeah. If there is no definitive authority, then we know. A deconstructive must aim, right? Because then it can make the unseen visible if there is no definitive authority. So one is looking good. The meaning of the text is based on binary opposites. No, that has nothing to do. Binary opposites, according to Derrida, are everywhere. The implicit power relationship is often ignored. Power relationships not mentioned. Any act of interpretation must refer. No, in fact, he's saying the author is not the final judge. So answer is 1 year also and 1 year also. Right? Great. Now let's look at the para completion, an interesting but very clear set of options for each paragraph. The audience for crosswords and Sudoku understandably overlap greatly, but there are differences too. A crossword attracts a more literary person, while Sudoku appeals to a keenly logical mind. Yeah, so people who are interested in language will do crossword, whereas Sudoku will be done by logical people. Some crossword enthusiasts turn up their noses at Sudoku because they feel it lacks depth. A good crossword requires vocabulary, knowledge, mental flexibility, and sometimes even a sense of humor to complete. It touches numerous areas of life positively and provides an aha or two along the way. Sudoku, on the other hand, is just a logical exercise, each one similar to the last. So you are comparing, right? Why would some crossword enthusiasts say Sudoku does not lack depth? Because there are so many things possible, whereas here, all of them are similar. So one is looking good. One really completes properly. Sudoku, incidentally, is growing faster in popularity even. Why would I introduce suddenly a positive for Sudoku, right? In the end, it does not go with the whole flow. Sudoku, again, 3 is a positive. So close is 1 or 4. Sudoku, however, is not exciting in any sense of the term. But guys, is there anything exciting given? It's about depth. It's about how each of them are different. And here, everything is similar. So 1 is better than 4. Best is option 1. Next. Most firms consider expert individuals to be too elitist, temperamental, egocentric, and difficult to work with. Force such people to collaborate on a high-stakes project and they just might come to fisticuffs. Even the very notion of managing such a group seems unimaginable. Basically, you can't manage expert individuals. So most organizations fall into default mode, setting up project teams of people who get along nicely, which means they are not expert individuals. The result, however, is disastrous. No, yeah, so many organizations are working quite well, so it's not disastrous. But yeah, the result could be mediocrity. 1 is too extreme. 2 is okay. The result is creation of experts. No, you can't create experts like this easily, right? Naturally, they drive innovations. Why would people who are not experts drive innovations? So best is option 2. That if you get people who are not expert individuals, right? They will get along nicely, but the result is mediocrity. Right? Great. Next one. Here we are back again with Mr. Federer. As I've told you, he's a favorite with cat paper setters. Federer's 5th Grand Slam win prompted a reporter to ask whether he was the best ever. Federer, certainly not lacking in confidence, but he wasn't about to proclaim himself the best ever. The best player of this generation, yes, he said, but nowhere close to ever. Just look at the records that some guys have. I'm a minnow. Minnow means somebody who's small compared to others, right? A small item. His win against Agassi contradicts that. A single win is not going to contradict and make someone the best ever. So, one is not going to work here, right? Sampras, the king of an earlier generation, was as humble. Why are we introducing another Grand Slam player? He's more than a minnow too. So you see how well this continues and completes. I'm just a minnow, but he's more than a minnow to his contemporary. So we'll keep this. The difference between the best, this is all bakwas. 4th option is bakwas, right? So answer is option 3. Great. Last one. Thus, the end of knowledge and the closing of the frontier that it symbolizes is not a looming crisis at all, but merely one of many embarrassing fits of hubris in civilization's long industry. In the end, it will pass away and be forgotten. Ours is not the first generation to struggle to understand the organizational laws of the frontier, deceive itself that it has succeeded, and go to its grave having failed. Okay, so see, what is the main thing this person is saying? End of knowledge is not a looming crisis at all, but just one of the embarrassing fits of hubris. Hubris is a break in civilization's long industry. In the end, it will pass away and be forgotten. We are not the first generation. So this will keep happening, right? But we might be the first generation to actually reach the frontier. Which frontier? Which frontier? There is just this, we don't even know clearly which frontier. To deal with the crisis. No, but this, it symbolizes is not a looming crisis. There is no particular crisis to deal with. However, this time the success is not illusory. No. See, this is, we are going to deceive ourselves. If we are going to fail, and hence it would be wise if we are humble. So best is option one as your answer, right? Great, guys. So I hope you all enjoyed this session. Here is your puzzle, something to think over. 3 white candles and 2 black candles can be arranged in a number of ways in a pentagon-shaped candle round. God knows why people are making pentagons. That's not good news. If the candles are placed at random, find the probability that the 3 white candles will be adjacent. So please think about this. We'll discuss this in the next class. This is your reading assignment. It's how, you know, language can really change on how we think. Just because we did Derrida, I thought, let's, you know, look at how language can make a difference in our lives, right? I'll see you again when we do the 2005 DILR in the evening. And of course, you can find me on Unacademy. So guys, please, as I said in the beginning also, there are great features in the app. You have so many live animations, so many great content leaders, content educators, and currently we are having a great test series. So please, guys, go ahead. You have live doubt clearing sessions as well. Which subscription to go for? Well, if you're focused on CAT 20, you can look at the 12-month subscription. But if you're focused, if you're confused between CAT 20 and CAT 21, then you can look at the 2-year subscription, right? You can use the code MUNIRA10 to get a 10% discount. So great, guys. I'll see you soon. Take care. Bye-bye.